Welcome, everybody. I'm delighted at the opportunity here to moderate the first session. Many of you know, back in summer of 2014, the White House embarked on an initiative to address space weather, the growing needs in this country for space weather services and for better understanding of space weather, to build in better resilience against this threat of space weather. October 2015, strategy was done, released, and we're here today because a huge piece of that strategy is Goal 6, as Judy mentioned, addressing or interacting with our international partners to address this threat. What we're going to do in the panel here this morning, I'm going to set the stage just a little bit. I know some people in the audience here don't know a whole lot about space weather. I'm not going to do a space weather 101. Some of my colleagues here in this panel will talk a little bit more in detail about space weather, but I do want to just talk a little bit about it and why the White House did embark on an initiative to address this growing threat of space weather. When we talk about space weather, essentially what we're looking at is emissions or eruptions from the sun. The sun, like the Earth, has a north pole and south pole, a negative and a positive polarity, but it does something a little quirky, a little bit strange. Every 11 years, it does a reversal of the poles with a negative and positive polarity switch, and it's during that reversing process, sunspots emerge, which are localized magnetic stress on the sun, and these localized magnetic stressed areas can produce big eruptions. When these big eruptions occur, they produce all sorts of emissions. On the slide here, you'll see electromagnetic radiation, energetic charged particles, and very, very important is magnetic field eruptions, all coming from these explosions on the sun that can impact technology here on Earth. The emissions arrive, it can impact our Earth's magnetic field. It can impact the ionosphere near us, and it affects satellite systems, all sorts of technology. And it is that very reason, the technology that can be affected, is why essentially we are here today. We have become so reliant on advanced technology for everything we do, it is hard to imagine today what a few hours or a few days would be like without our GPS system, without our satellite systems, period, satellite communications, and all the other applications we rely on from satellites. And of course, that other piece that perhaps was the biggest driver than anything else in the United States to drive this strategy, potential impact on the electric power grid. Important to note too, some people think that this is somewhat theory, hypothetical. It is not. Space weather occurs quite regularly. This is just a hodgepodge of activity, so space weather activity over the last 4, 5, 6 years or so, impacting different technology. And you'll see a couple of takeaways here. Lots of different technology getting impacted, and it is indeed very much global. It's one thing that makes this phenomenon of space weather just a little bit different than most everything else. When these big eruptions occur, the Earth is just a tiny spot that gets engulfed from the eruptions, the emissions from the sun. So it is very much a global phenomenon. But you'll look here and you'll see actually that top one just happened in November of 2015 when a solar flare erupted and shut down the airspace over Sweden. Didn't know why, weren't quite sure. It's led to a lot of questions, and it's kind of stuff that we're doing in our strategies to try to understand exactly how such impacts can occur. But you'll see that solar flares can impact aviation, satellite systems, and so on through over the last couple of years. Just several very good examples. So recognizing this vulnerability to space weather and our understanding an improved understanding of extreme space weather motivated us to action. So we put a team together in the White House. We spent the best part of a year developing a strategy and action plan, and in October 2015, the strategy and action plan were released at the some fanfare at the White House. Judy mentioned this. I just wanted to elaborate one more time. We had six strategic goals in this national strategy, and goal six is increase international cooperation. She mentioned we have to build international support and policies. We're doing that today. We also are going to do it this afternoon as we explore opportunities to have ministerial-level negotiations about this threat of space weather. The second goal, when we talk about increased engagement with international community, and a lot of that going on already, we want to ensure we continue some of the great work and improve, in fact, over on the great work that's going on with data sharing, modeling, scientific research. At last, or the third piece here, strengthen coordination of space weather products and services. That's kind of a little bit different, again, than everything else. What we do not want to happen, folks, is if we have an airplane flying out of Heathrow or Munich heading to New York, and we got the space weather folks in Europe saying one thing about the event that's about to happen or is happening, and the United States saying something different, and we've got pilots coming back and forth hearing different things. We have to be consistent, however we're going to do that, in our messaging. A lot of activity on the way. I see my colleagues from the FAA are here today, and they are working very closely with the United Nations International Civil Aviation Organization to ensure standards are developed, global standards, to address space weather. And that last piece, of course, promote a collaborative international approach to the preparedness part. Our colleagues in the Department of Homeland Security, FEMA, et cetera, working those issues as we speak.